Welcome to the show today. We are so thankful that you have tuned in to Reality Church. We have teachings and dancing and songs and prayer and testimonies of how you can experience God outside the stained glass windows. So we thank you for tuning in today, and we have a show prepared for you.
It's been so exciting to share what God is doing outside of the church. Church is real important. We're instructed to go to church. But some people say that's the only place. But Jesus wants to help us in the marketplace, on the street, wherever we are, whatever town you're in. So this has been exciting for me to present Jesus as a total picture. He helps us with family relationships, helps us with finances, with our health issues, with spirituality, and most of all, he helps us with eternity. Eternity is so much longer than this life. It's worth having some internal evaluation of where you stand with God. Because Jesus Christ died on the cross for us. And the Bible says that we need to ask him into our life.
Searching for words to tell you, trying to show that I still care. So many things have changed, still so much that we can share.
I wanted to talk to you about is that so many people feel that we've already been through the tribulation, and now that there's peace in Israel and around there, that surely we're going to just walk right into the new millennium for 1,000 years of peace, and they feel like we've already done the tribulation. What do you say to a person like that?
When it comes to that interpretation of the Bible, it's a little bit vague, and part of the situation in my mind is that when I think of the Great Tribulation as if there haven't been tribulations for the last 2,000 years, Jesus himself said there would be tribulation. But I believe there's going to come a time when that tribulation is not accompanied by the hope of salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. And that tribulation has never existed. So I'm thinking there is going to come a time when it's too late. There will still be humanity on the earth, but...
Well, can you kind of tell our viewers a little bit of what the Bible says in Revelation, that we come to this place in history we call the end times, and truly is the end of the world as we know it. We're coming into a different time slot, different age. So how do we encourage others of what God has planned?
I think the most encouraging thing about the end times is that for those who are exposed to the gospel through faith in Jesus Christ, that you have an eternity with God in paradise. I've been reading through quite a bit of scholarly work lately about the end times, and when you say, what does the book of Revelation say, or what does the book of Daniel say, or what does the book of Isaiah say, you can spend an enormous amount of time, and I haven't looked up every single scripture, but there's substantial amounts of scriptural evidence that could lead to various conclusions about the exact nature of the end times and the last days. Now, there's most of the Bible scholars for the past 2,000 years have believed what you said, that we would come to a point where heaven would come to earth through the salvation of the gospel message, and that we would have 1,000 years of peace and tranquility led by Christ. But that is what they call the amillennial view, and most of the Bible scholars had given up on that about 150 years ago when they realized that the gospel message has been spread all around the world. Christianity does exist all around the world, and yet politically and nationally and internationally, things continue to get worse, not better. So the idea that we can establish the heaven on earth through the proclamation of the gospel appears to be not substantiated by human history. So we're going to have something a little bit more radical than just conversion to Christ through faith and the gospel.
Yeah, well, the Bible talks about the Battle of Armageddon, and
right,
all the nations are going to come against Israel. Well, some people are saying they've already come against Israel for all these years, and now they're starting to come together. So we've already had that tribulation. We've already had that Armageddon experience. So now let's go into peace. But I think there's something more.
When I read about the president's got some of these Arab nations forming peace treaties with Israel, and this is supposed to be such great news, I like that message, because I don't think that we as Christians want to live in a world filled with hate and wars and violence. But it does kind of strike a note that, you know, at the last days, people will be saying peace, peace, but there's not going to be peace.
Yeah.
So I don't rest too assured in the Nobel Peace Prize for the president striking up peace agreements with Arab nations. But I don't trust the non-Christian world at all, whether they have a peace treaty or not. I see the secular communists in Asia imprisoning and torturing and killing people. I see the same thing going on in India. The Hindus are torturing, killing, and arresting people who are not agreeing with them. Throughout the Middle East, there's a lot of torturing and imprisoning and killing with people that don't agree with them on a religious basis.
So
no matter what they say about peace treaties with Arabs, I just don't see that leading to peace. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. The only peace is going to come through faith in Jesus. And that peace may not spare us from persecution or even execution. That peace is between us and God. And that's real peace.
And he's able to take us through a time like that. That's beyond our imagination.
Well, he might.
He can put food on the table where there's no food. He can take pain away where there has been pain.
Amen.
And he could... Man can take our body, but he can't take our soul.
No.
And instant with him forevermore.
Yeah, one of the things about God that we fail to comprehend is that he's not on the earth spinning on its axis giving him days, and orbiting the sun, giving him years. He's everywhere in the universe and everywhere in existence. So God's concept of time and space is completely different from ours. Even the greatest thinkers in the history of mathematics have concluded that existence is a matter of time and space, but they're not sure exactly what that is. That's why they call it theoretical astrophysics. But it's not theoretical to God.
Yeah. Well, this has been a very good discussion, and we will continue. But let's have Poppy Fars do another dance for us.
Amen.
All right. Poppy Fares, new in our community from Atwater, California.
Amen. Amen. So I just wanted to share just a brief testimony of God's goodness. I came to know the Lord in 2000, so I'm pretty much a baby Christian. The Lord just had me captivated immediately. When I fell for Him, I fell hard, and it was a good fall. Just immediately, I felt so tender in my heart towards Him, and it was a really big change, my life before Christ and my life after Christ. My life before Christ, you would probably cross the street if you saw me. My life after Christ, I'm just a whole new person. The Bible says that we become a new creation in Christ, and I just want to attest to that, that, you know, He truly changes you from the inside out. He changes everything about you. He changes your demeanor. He changes your heart. He changes your mind, and it's all for the better. Recently, as Karen mentioned, I just moved to this community of Santa Cruz, and this has been a desire of my heart for over 28 years. I met my husband, and we came to Santa Cruz, and we lived here for about 6 or 8 months before the earthquake of October 1989. And after the earthquake, we decided that we should go home and be with our families. And so we moved back to the Central Valley. But it was really on my heart to be here, in my husband's heart. And he just recently, in May of 2020, this year, in the middle of the pandemic and every other thing that's happening, moved us here to Santa Cruz. And it has been the desire of my heart. And when I moved here, I left a church community, a family that I had been with for 20 years. And God knew that I was very fixed in my place of worship. I loved my place of worship. I loved the people that I worshiped with. I loved the ministries that I was involved with, and one of them was dance ministry. And it was really tearing in my heart to move away and to break away from that dance ministry that I had been in for several years. And after a very short time of being here in Santa Cruz, I met a lady, and we met at the gas station, because God will use any place at any time. And she invited me to gather with some other believers, some prophetic believers, in the park, and we had amazing times of worship and ministry there. And she asked me to come and to dance. And only the Lord knew how special that was for me. You know, as I was packing up from Atwater, trying to decide if I would hold on to my garments or if I would share them with another ministry, the Lord said, just pack everything away, nice and neat. One day you're going to unpack them again and you're going to use them. And so this has been such a blessing to me to be able to come today and minister and dance. And I just want to share just a small portion out of the passage that my brother shared, something that really spoke to me. My brother Richard, when he shared out of 2 Peter 3, and verse 14 is something that really struck my heart this morning. It says, so my beloved friends, with all you have to look forward to, may you be eager to be found living pure lives when you come into His presence, without blemish and filled with peace. Peace is who Jesus is. Peace is not only what He gives, but it's where we get to live in Him. And so I just thank the Lord for that perfect peace that surpasses all understanding. I mean, there are situations and moments in our lives that we just truly don't understand. And we may seek the Lord on those things. And when He blankets us in His peace, we just know everything is going to be okay in Him. And so we're just grateful to be here today with my new family in Christ.
Well, I have a verse I'd like to read. So let's change places.
Let's do it.
And
so I'm Karen Barton, and I've done this show for a number of years. So welcome to Reality Church, a place where we have church outside the stained glass windows, and we have a little dance, a little prayer, a little song, and teachings. And so that's what we're doing today. And so I have a scripture I'd like to read from the book of Jude. Jude is not read very often. It's just a one chapter book. And it has some really strong things to say, but right at the end of it, it's talking about a call to remain faithful. But you, my delightfully loved friends, constantly and progressively build yourselves up on the foundation of your most holy faith by praying every moment in the Spirit. Fasten your hearts to the love of God and receive the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ, who gives us eternal life. And this is why we are so involved in producing a show and talking to people about the love of God, because it's eternity. Eternity is a long time. I was a math teacher. We learned about infinity. And eternity is one of those things that has no end. So we want you as a listener to spend eternity in heaven. And we either accept God's provision or we reject it. So he doesn't send people to hell. He doesn't let them miss out. But we do it ourselves. So we're humbly coming before you and asking, follow the scripture and see what God wants for your life. So I just want to reread this portion that I read a little bit ago. And I want it to sink into your heart. But you, my delightfully loved friends, constantly and progressively build yourselves up on the foundation of your most holy faith. That means we need to come to God. And Romans 10, 9 and 10 says to believe that Jesus died on the cross and that he raised from the dead. And when you confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. So that's the holy foundation of faith. It's a simple foundation, but it is so strong and so solid. And it carries us through all the fires, all the difficulties, all the sicknesses, and all the things that come our way. We have no control over what comes our way, but we have control of how we react to it. And when we react with God's faith, with his promises, and say, your Bible says this, God, I want this in my life, he will work it out and give us the solution that we need. So the praying every moment in the Spirit. So we need to pray, we need to be close to God, and to be in the Spirit is to really commune with him. He tells us to take communion. The grape juice and the crackers is what our church usually does, but you can use wine or any kind of cracker that you want, or bread, but the bread represents the brokenness of his body that was broken on the cross, and the wine is his blood was shed for us to give us salvation. So the every moment in the Spirit is when we're recognizing that God provided that communion or that connection with us. Fasten your hearts to the love of God. And to me, that means to take these words to heart and really learn how to worship him, to love him, to say that you love him, to make your actions show that you are loving and you're following the principles in the Bible, to receive the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ, who gives us eternal life. I'm going to read another section I didn't read before. Keep being compassionate to those who still have doubts. So keep helping others to believe and have faith. And snatch others out of the fire to save them. So there's some people going to come to you in your life that you're going to have the answer. You're going to have this Bible. You're going to have a scripture verse a word of encouragement that's going to be life to them. And that is when we fulfill this scripture. Snatch others out of the fire to save them. Be merciful and over to those, but always couple your mercy with the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord is knowing that He is the boss and that He set the rules. It's His heaven and we're going to His house to have eternity. And we can't do it by our rules. Some people say, we're all Christians from the beginning. I can do whatever I want and God's going to let me into heaven. The Bible says He is the one that we need to reverence His rules and what He says about heaven. Be extremely careful to keep yourselves free from the pollutions of the flesh. And when we can keep our lives free from hate and immorality and anger, we really have a much happier life. We have more peace and we have the joy of the Lord. And that's the kind of life that God wants us to have. And so we encourage you this morning to, or whatever time it is when you're watching this show, to let that peace come into your life and turn your heart over to Him. I remember one of the shows, we had a gentleman that had a gun and he was going to kill himself. And he turned the TV show on. He was listening to Reality Church just like you are today. And he just said, well, I need somebody to talk to. And so the minister that was doing the show that day said, just call. If you have a problem, just call and we'll pray with you. Well, this was at almost midnight and he figured, I can't call anybody right now. Everybody's asleep. Nobody's going to answer the phone. Well, he went ahead and called. And that minister happened to be right there and answered the phone call and led him to the Lord. So whatever your situation, you be surprised how God will turn things around. And just a simple little thing, I was just helping with a situation where we were giving things away and we had on the table all these supplies and somebody gave us a box of Love's diapers, size 4. And everybody that came to the table, we kept saying, could you use some diapers? Could you use some diapers? And they sat there for over a day. And finally, this lady came up and we said, would you like some diapers? And she says, they're size 4. I just went to the store and bought size 5 and they're the wrong size and I didn't know what to do. So we traded boxes. And then the next time I was there, the other size was gone too. So it's amazing what God will do if you just trust Him and ask Him to help. And so today we've asked Poppy to come and do some dancing and to show you how to worship the Lord in a free, relaxed way of doing this. You can get out in your yard and do some of the same things that Poppy's going to do this morning. And you can just love God and worship Him. That's what He wants. He wants your heart. So thank you for tuning in today. And I pray that this show will help you to go to the next step in your development with Christ. Bless you.
I'm Pastor Richard from here in Aptos. And I like to teach on the Bible, and it's what I consider the biblical worldview. It seems the world today is in a war, an open war, a revolution. And the struggle is between the materialistic worldview, which claims there is no God, there are no spiritual forces, there are no heavens or hells or angels, and then there's the biblical worldview. So let me talk a little bit about the biblical worldview, which is that God created the universe and everything in it, this planet. He set it in motion by creating Adam and Eve, creating the woman out of man, a handful of dirt. The two shall become one flesh. Obviously, the Bible teaches that marriage is a man and a woman, one flesh. And as history progressive, there have been certain events which stand out prominent, and these things stand out prominently in all ancient histories. The flood of Noah, Abraham moving to the Middle East. These events are still current. The conflicts are still in action thousands of years later. We basically have God promising to Abraham a nation with people. Along comes about 2,000 years later, about 1,000 years later, we have Moses and all the laws, the legislation, the people with its boundaries, confirming the legitimacy of Israel as a nation. Right now, there's a lot of people throughout the world that don't believe that Israel has a right to be a nation, and that's part of the conflict. The world eventually will come to a conclusion when the nations of the world attack Israel to destroy it, and God comes to their defense. Right in the middle of the history of mankind, we have God himself coming to the earth, the bread which came down from heaven, and that's Jesus Christ, whose shed blood on the cross was the blood of God, actually atoning for the sins of mankind. So that through faith in Jesus Christ, you become qualified to have a personal relationship with God through the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Now we've got 2,000 years of more history, at the conclusion of which God has promised that the Messiah will return. And certain events will come into existence that will lead us into the second coming. The biblical worldview has God starting the heavens and the earth and then creating a new heaven and a new earth. And that's what we're waiting for now. So I would kind of like to read something from 2 Peter. It talks about the day of the Lord. Let's see if this, the secular world, the materialistic world is claiming that man-made climate change is causing a lot of trouble. And I believe they say that because they can't acknowledge the existence of God, that these are all acts of God. It says, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. Therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and goodness? Now, if you read through the book of Galatians, it talks about the deeds of the flesh and the deeds of the spirit. And I believe when you're living according to the deeds of the flesh, I'm not going to look it up, but we know what they are, pretty much. Sexual immorality, drunkenness, drug abuse, hatreds, wars. These are the acts of the devil. And believers should be careful not to participate in the deeds of the flesh. Even though we all make mistakes, we all have our human weaknesses. We should be living in the Spirit, and the deeds of the Spirit is love and goodness and kindness and generosity. So that's what it says. You ought to be in holy conduct and godliness. That holy conduct, it talks about holy conduct. That's because it's the Holy Spirit provides the ability to live holy. Man apart from God has no ability to live holy. And godliness. Verse 12, now looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be dissolved, being on fire. Not hard to imagine that in the west coast of the United States nowadays. And the elements will melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. See, when you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and those whose names are found written in the Lamb's Book of Life, will spend eternity in the new heaven and the new earth with God himself. One of the reasons why they call it the day of the Lord is because the sun, moon, and stars will also not exist after that, so that the earth will not be orbiting around the sun. You won't have the moon and stars for measuring the seasons and the times. God himself will be the light. Jesus will be the lamp. In the new heaven and the new earth, there will not be days and time as we know it now. It will be brand new. See, if you don't believe in God and you don't believe those things, you have to blame it on man. With this secular materialism, God himself becomes a man. Man becomes the God of that political system. That man takes the place of God. That man determines the laws. Man determines the rights. But it's not true, though. Truth, see, this book is truth. God's word is truth. And truth is reality. And reality is that God himself has created law. God himself has created nature. And it's God himself who will create our future on a new heaven and a new earth. It says, nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. And as the body of Christ, I think we should be looking towards Jesus. We shouldn't allow the world to condition us towards not believing that God is our healer, that God is our strength. Not condition us to think that we have to get our temperatures taken and we have to wear a mask in order to be safe, in order to be loving, because it's not true. Our hope comes in Jesus Christ. Jesus is our healer, and Jesus anointed his apostles and his disciples to heal all diseases and to heal all sicknesses. So in this time of political crisis, we look to Jesus as the solution to these problems. You know, it talks about, therefore, looking forward to these things, be diligent to be found by him in peace, without spot, and blameless. That means to be in Christ, because only in Christ are we without spot and blameless. And account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation. See, God doesn't come back. You know, these words were written 2,000 years ago, nearly 2,000 years ago. And they were thinking at that time that the second coming was right around the corner. Now, 2,000 years later, I'm sure everybody listening to me, all the body of Christ listening to this message, are thinking that the second coming of Jesus is right around the corner. But it says he comes like a thief in the night. Well, when the thief is coming, he doesn't tell you when he's coming. So I'm recommending that we do everything we can to have faith in Christ and to live in the filling of the Holy Spirit and to stay away from the deeds of the flesh as a body of Christ. And we have to support each other and build each other up and work together towards the day of the Lord, which could be soon, very soon.
I found peace in the river. I found peace by the quiet streams. And I found peace on the mountain. I found peace in fields of green. And I found peace in the desert. I found peace in the raging waves. And I found peace in the valley. I found peace in what you said. Oh, and I
I just want to tell you a little bit about my feeling what God is developing a ministry. And the situation is that there are a lot of bad things going on with children, with mind control. And I think a lot of this is being exposed. It's just kind of this time in history that God is tired of it, and he doesn't want it to be that way anymore. So I think we're at a place where things are being exposed. I have a friend that's been working with satanic ritual abuse victims. And this is a group of mostly girls. There's guys that have been abused, but I'm interested in a girls' home to help to restore these people to what they should be and the freedom that they should have. And so the ministry that I want, I envision and that I want God to provide the funds for is to have a home where these people could live, receive the needs they have physically, because a lot of them have health issues, and spiritual issues, to break the bondage that Satan is allowed to place upon their lives through abuse and planned mind control, making sex slaves out of these people. God doesn't want that. And so I see a home being developed, and I thank the Lord that he will provide the funds if we're supposed to do this. I am working with a lady that is she's under a mentorship program with Dan Duvall, which is a ministry out of Texas. He has a lot of victims that have been restored and brought to Christ. And of those victims, a lot of them need to have places to live that are secure or safe, away from all the public eyes. And so I'm asking God for a piece of property and for funds to build a place for them to be. So I don't even know the name of it. I don't even know who all is going to be involved, but we're having Bible studies on Sunday nights, and it's growing. And as soon as my friend gets out of the mentorship program, we're actually going to start meeting and encourage bigger groups to come. So I just wanted to say that. So start praying for women that need to be restored, and that God would provide, and that we would have enough people to work with them that would help them. They'd have the things that they need. And we just are believing for miracles, for a new life for them, that they can move from where they have been in bondage to freedom. But in that situation, when you are healed of a certain kind of disease, you usually have ministry in that area. So if you've been healed of cancer, then when you see a cancer victim, you can go and pray for them. Well, these ladies have been sex slaves, have been ritually abused, and I believe that they have victory in those areas that are stronger than any of us could ever do. And so if we can raise up an army of these people that are restored, look what it's going to do to our nation and to our world. So pray with us. Thank you very much.
Invest in the lives of those who had no hope. He chose to spend time building relationships and restoring the lives of the most unlikely members of society. Jesus became their source of hope.
Jesus has changed my life.
Jesus is changing my life.
Jesus has changed my life.
Jesus has changed my life.
Jesus has changed my life.
Jesus changed my life.
Jesus is changing my life.
The teachings of Jesus are the same philosophies applied to each Teen Challenge program. Jesus taught love and forgiveness. When lives are restored through the teaching of Jesus, they are changed forever.
God has blessed me with restoration. His grace has given me a hope, blessed me with the ability to serve and be a servant and bring hope and the message of grace to people in the community, kids out there that don't know God and people that don't know God and people with the same just lack of hope in their life that I once had.
Why is Teen Challenge one of the most effective drug recovery programs in America? Because we know that to be successful, an addict needs to move from a self-centered paradigm to a Christ-centered paradigm.
Since God came into my life, you know, it's been all nothing but blessings after blessing, and I'm just grateful for what He's done in my life. You know.
Teen Challenge believes in holding Jesus Christ as our standard, and all actions, thoughts, and behaviors should reflect the character of Jesus. We teach men and women to read and know the Word of God so that they can get to know the God of the Word.
Now I'm on the right path. Teen Challenge has done a lot for me. I'm growing in the Word.
Teen Challenge of Monterey Bay is a Christian discipleship program. Our focus is on giving men and women the opportunity to come to know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. The next step is then learning to make Him Lord. The program is a minimum of 13 months long. Devotions, Bible readings, chapels, and church participation are essential elements of the program. Men are given the opportunity to come to know Jesus personally, and many choose to be baptized. Teen Challenge of Monterey Bay thrives upon several core values and principles. First and foremost, we believe that every person that enters our doors is valuable to God. We believe that our students are exceptional human beings and are called, gifted, and equipped to do the work of the Lord. We also believe that all staff must be called by God and that every student at Monterey Bay Teen Challenge has been brought to our center by divine appointment. We are a grace-based, non-denominational center that teaches the idea of simple Christianity. We invest our lives in our students one-on-one and in small groups. A desire to change is not enough. Transformation requires a commitment. All behavior is chosen, and we choose success in Christ. Both the scriptures and staff are reliable and predictable. Students will demonstrate transformed lives through dependability. Our last core value is balance. The program and staff model consistency and moderation. Balance will promote sobriety and a productive and meaningful life. Since Teen Challenge first opened its doors, thousands have come seeking help and have found the Helper. God is in the business of changing lives, and Teen Challenge provides every man or woman that chance. If you have a loved one, family member, or close friend struggling with a life-controlling issue, Teen Challenge is here to help.
My precious daughter, you are my beloved child, in whom I am so pleased. I am your father who adores you. I love you. I've always loved you. I don't love you because of what you can do for me. I love you because you are mine. Not for any other reason. You are mine. I love you with a passionate, strong, and immovable love, and I will never, ever change my mind. I not only love you, but I really, really like you. I like what I made. I like who you are. When I made you, you were my dream fulfilled. I delight in you. I celebrate you. I dance over you, and I sing my songs of pleasure over you. I'm very, very proud of you. I'm thrilled to call you mine. You're doing so good. You're doing so much better than you think you are. Keep going, my child. And I want you to know that you measure up. You are enough. Even if others have told you otherwise, my voice of truth is the only voice that matters. And I think you are absolutely astounding. You're my success story. I'm not done yet. Just watch what I do with your life. My child, I bless you. Not reluctantly, but wholeheartedly, I give to you my Father's blessing. It's my heart's desire to bless you. So I bless you with my favor. And I bless you with my goodness. I bless you with my grace. My grace is doing for you what you couldn't do for me in a million years. I bless you with my peace. And I bless you with my joy. I bless you with the full inheritance of my kingdom that's yours through my son, Jesus. Everything that's mine is yours. I hold nothing back from you because you are mine. You are my chosen prince. My chosen princess with full access to my kingdom. My royalty is in your blood. I want you to know that I'm on your side, no matter what. I'm totally for you, always. I want you with all of my heart. And I will have you as my very own forever. My beloved child, my heart is your home. Enter into the joy of my heart and my kingdom. Not someday, but right now.
So thank you for watching, and we trust that as you have listened to the Word of God, that you have heard how you can become a Christian and how you can have this faith in your life too. And we will come back again. We thank you for tuning in, and have a very blessed week. Bye.